Good morning, everyone, and welcome. It is time for Ridgewood Live. Come on in this morning and welcome. Get your Bibles and go ahead and get settled. We're going to be camped out in the book of 1 Peter this morning as we continue our message on a sojourner's guide to hope in a hostile world. That's 1 Peter, and we're going to be in chapter 2. I'm Pastor Jim, and I'm looking so forward to spending this morning with you. Please let us know when you get on. And say hello to us. If you're watching from out of town, please let us know where you're watching from. If you are new to us this morning, we want to encourage you to get over to our website, lovemyrbc.com, and click on guest card and fill that out for us. We'd love to have a record of your attendance. We want to say hello to you. But come on in, and we also want you to be free to use that thumbs up button, that heart button, and that care button. Like, love, and care, all that you feel led to do all through the service this morning. And then we want to make sure that you hit that share button. Share it out to your neck of the woods. Send it out to your friends and your family. We grow our ministry by you being involved and you hitting the share button. We'll be starting at 10:30, so settle in, and we'll be starting soon.
morning, folks. Good morning, good morning. Good morning, good morning. As our praise team is making their way up, we want to start this morning just like we did last Sunday morning. We want to open with just a time of quiet, a time of prayer. And so we just want to say thank you for being with us. Thank you for watching online this morning. We're so privileged that you have chosen Ridgewood as your place of worship. But we're just going to ask you right now just to bow your heads. If you would like to come to this altar and pray, please feel free to do that. And so we're just going to have that time of quiet. And in just a few seconds, I will open us with prayer. And then our team will lead in worship. So if you'll just bow with me and anyone who would like to, come on and make your way to the altar. Said this day will bring you glory and bring you honor. Father, we ask you, Father, just to remove all distractions. Father, hide us behind the cross this morning, Father, as we just seek to hear from you. Father, forgive me. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please. All hail King Jesus, all hail Emmanuel, King of kings, Lord of lords, bright morning star. And throughout eternity, I'll sing your praises, and I'll
will be. beautiful, isn't it? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. For all that you've done, I will thank you. For all that you're going to do. For all that you promised and all that you are is all that has carried me through. Jesus, I thank you. And I thank you. Thank you, Lord. And I thank you. I thank you. Thank you.
No grace.
greater picture of love in all the world than him laying down his life for a wretch such as me. And God, it was our sins that held him to the cross, just like the word said. It wasn't those nails. It wasn't the Roman soldiers. It was our sins that held him there till it was finished, because he knew what had to be done. And for that, I am eternally grateful. And I pray everyone in the hearing of my voice this morning is as well. And if they don't know the price that was paid that they might have life, that, Lord, this day, somehow, some way, they would come to understand that, so that you might receive the honor and the glory for all that we do. In Christ's name.
We're going to be headed back to 1 Peter this morning. If you want to go ahead and turn your Bibles over and go ahead and get ready. 1 year ago today, we were out back in the parking lot, straight up in the middle of the DeVaysers camper. And I'm just going to say right now, that was probably two of the funnest weeks I think I've ever had in my life to be out there. I don't know about y'all, remember that? That was fun, wasn't it? Because we beat the odds. We wasn't supposed to do that. And I was so thankful for that opportunity to continue, and thankful for Leonard and Heath allowing us to use that. It was such a phenomenal tool. Aren't you glad that the same gospel that was here a year ago is the same gospel today? Because just because we're not out there does not mean that the gospel is not in here. We have to understand that. In our scriptural text today, here in 1 Peter, Simon Peter is literally unloading rail car after rail car of spiritual depth and spiritual wisdom to those Sojourner Christians. And folks, they needed every word of it. If you've read through and if you've studied 1 and 2 Peter, you understand the need so great. And church, if we're honest, everything that Simon Peter is unpacking here in this book is so needed today. We need every word of it. There were words of hope to thousands of Christians that were scattered everywhere. Christianity was struggling. Persecution was in full swing. False teachers were everywhere, and they were infiltrating the church at every level. They were peddling their snake oil remedies as a way to replace the one true gospel, and hope was truly beginning to be in short supply. As we look around our country today, does any of that sound familiar? How about if we look in the mirror? Does that look familiar? Is it easy to say this morning that as a Christian, there's days we struggle? Is there days as Christians that we get to the point to where we just want to say, I'm done? Amen. The world's beating you on this side, and you turn to get away from it, and it's over here, and you go this way, and it's over there. And so it is a consistent onslaught of the world that's trying to get you to believe that God is not who he says he is, and that the gospel that you proclaim to know is not the one true gospel. It's everywhere. It's in our media, television, radio, social media. It's in our communities, and folks, it's in our churches today, amen? It's here. As we looked last week, everything around you and everything about you will wither and fade away. Everything except the Word of God. See, Peter was explicitly clear about the eternality of the Word of God. Everything you can lay your hands on, everything, will wither and fade away. But the Word of God lasts forever. And that means that nothing the world can ever offer, literally you name it, can stand up against the Word of God. And I say amen. And it was by the Word of God that brought about their freedom in the first place. And this is where Simon Peter's trying to get him to. It's like Paul when he told the church at Rome in Romans chapter 10, verse 17, when he said this, "So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." See, this is the same as you and I when we gave our life to Christ. And we touched on this just a little bit last week. You see, the gospel was delivered to us. Some of us by a sermon. Some of us it was by a Sunday school lesson. Some by just a mere conversation. It doesn't matter the where. It doesn't matter the how. It matters the what. And the what is the living, breathing word of God that never, ever goes away. And that's what those Sojourner Christians needed. That's what we need. Now, I don't know about you, but if that's not a message of hope, I don't know what is. Aren't you glad to know that there's nothing can take that away? It's never going to diminish. The value of it is never going to decrease. And this was a much needed injection of hope to those Christians because they were being saturated in so much false doctrine and they were having to avoid persecution everywhere they turned that they must have felt like they were drowning. The book of 1 Peter is a lifeline. And already it has reached out and it has done so much good just in this first chapter. But Simon wasn't finished. Let's pick up this morning at chapter 2, verse 4. Simon writes this, "Coming to him, Jesus, as to a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious. You also, as living stones, are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Therefore, it is also contained in the scripture, 'Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame.' Therefore, to you who believe, he is precious. But to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble, being disobedient to the word to which they also were appointed. But you," this is to the Christian, "but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy." You know, every time that I look at my Colson man, it's my little grand boy, for those of you who don't know, whether it's a picture, whether it's a video, or whether I get to see him in person, every single time a flood of emotions runs right through me. Parents, you know what I'm feeling. Grandparents, you know what I'm talking about. And with those emotions comes an avalanche of adjectives that used to describe him. And we hear this all the time, especially about this little guy. He's so sweet. And he's such a big boy. And one of my favorites is just look at the innocence of that baby boy. You've used words like that for your grandchildren, haven't you? If you've seen that little boy and that little girl, that's Johnny and Dina's grandbabies, I promise you, they've used words like that for those little guys. You see, but through all of those words that are rushing through my heart about him, there's always one word, there's always one adjective that describes him that hits me first, and then everything else falls under that, and that word is precious. You see, that little guy's a lot of things to his papa, but precious is the one that screams at me just at the mere thought of that guy. He's precious. Do you ever think your kids are precious? You ever think your grandkids are precious? See, when we think of Jesus, we tend to think of him according to the names that describe him. For example, I've often asked you to give us the name that comes to you as to who Jesus is to you at the time. And we've heard names like Master, Savior, Lamb of God, Conqueror. He's all of that, amen? He is Counselor. He is Wonderful. He is Mighty God. He is Strong Tower. As one of our songs that we sing, He is the Waymaker. He is the Promise Keeper, the Miracle Worker. He is the Light in the Darkness. And the list goes on. And the list goes on. And you and I can just continue to bullet point those names as they go down. But if I were to ask you this morning, what are some adjectives that you would use to describe Jesus? Not the names, but what are some adjectives? What words best describe Him to you? And some of those words that we would hear is, He is loving. And He is loving, amen. He is kind. He is gentle. He is giving. He is forgiving. He is never failing. He is protecting. He is providing. And again, we could go on and on and on, and He is all of that and more, amen. But how many times would we think about using the word precious to define Jesus? Now you just think about that. How many times would we think about using the word precious? I mean, for real, would precious be one of the first descriptive words that would come out of your mouth to describe the Savior of the world? And if we're honest this morning, most of us are probably going to say no. And that's not a bad thing, it's just reality. The dictionary defines the word precious as an object, a substance, or a resource of great value, not to be wasted or treated carelessly. Other words that are similar, synonyms, if you will, of the word precious would be valuable, dear, invaluable, priceless, irreplaceable, inestimable. It's a hard word for my tongue to function. And I can assure you, as his granddad, that every one of these and more describe my Colson, man, without question. But we're not talking about my grandboy this morning. This text is about Jesus, the Son of the living God. And so why in the world would Simon Peter use this word to describe Jesus? Not once, but he used it twice, and then he referenced a quote from Isaiah 28 to use the word a total of three times in this text. Why? To Simon Peter, Jesus was precious. And this is the message he wanted to get out to those Sojourner Christians. And if you really want to think about it, this is a message that Christians today need to hear, because when you really process it, is Jesus not valuable? Is he not dear? Is he not invaluable? Is he not priceless? Is he not irreplaceable? Is he not inestimable? Amen. He is. So those words do describe Jesus Christ. But you see, here's the thing. Simon Peter knew at the end of the day that Jesus really was all of those words that you could ever think of to describe him. And as we talked about, he knows he's loving, he knows he's gentle, he knows he's kind. But it was precious that erupted out of his mouth, because he knew, Simon Peter knew what it was like to be in the trenches of life against a real enemy and to have an irreplaceable Savior that never gave up on him. Simon knew it. Simon Peter knew what it was like to take your eyes off Christ. Remember, it was him that got out of the boat, that walked on water until what? He took his eyes off Christ. Simon Peter knew what it was like to have a specific target put on your back that was placed there by Satan himself. Jesus told Simon, "Simon, Simon, Satan has asked for you by name that he may sift you as wheat." Simon knew that. Simon understood it. Simon knew what it was like to face his own personal demonic attacks. And Simon knew what it was like to fervently deny the Son of God not once, not twice, but three times. And so to Simon Peter, Jesus was precious. And that's the message that he's trying to get back. This is the message of hope that's going out to those Sojourner Christians. To Simon Peter, Jesus really was priceless. He was irreplaceable. He was inestimable. The word precious to Simon was personal. And it was that Jesus that many of those Sojourners had encountered on the day of Pentecost. But now the luster was leaving. The excitement was slowly going away and their faith was slipping. Does that describe some of us today? Do we sometimes think that as a Christian, the luster is leaving? The excitement is going away? Do you sometimes, come on, hear me out and you got to be honest. Do you sometimes feel like your faith is slipping? Amen? Every one of us in the room should have said that. Peter knew that those Sojourners needed reintroduced and reminded back to that Jesus. They needed hope. And Peter knew that the real hope was only found in Jesus. And I stand here to proclaim to you today that real hope can only be found in Jesus. Simon also tells them that Jesus is a living stone. He is a chief cornerstone. Let's look again at verse 5. He says, You also, talking to the Christians, you also as living stones are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Peter is painting them a picture that God is building a spiritual temple using living stones. And that's us. That's the Christians. And that they have come to the ultimate living stone in Jesus. Why? To offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Church, he's building us up. He's building us up. He's building us up, and Jesus Christ is the chief cornerstone. We are, what's those words that we looked at here? We are a holy priesthood. See, here's the thing. We don't need a mediator to get to God. Aren't you thankful for that? We don't need a mediator. Why? Because we have Jesus. He is the mediator. We don't need anyone to pray in our place. We have direct access. This passage right here is a strong confirmation into something that we as Southern Baptists understand that's called the doctrine of the priesthood of the believer. You and I are our own priest. If you remember back when we started our journey back in the Old Testament, we started in Exodus, and we know the things that were put in place. You had the Levite priest, and they're the ones who did all the work, and they did all the sacrifices for the people. Amen? You remember all that? And then we also understand that it was this kind of foolishness that the Judaizers were trying to get back into the church, that, well, you need to have this, and then you can still have your Jesus. And we all know that that's just as bogus. But here's the thing. You and I don't need someone else to offer sacrifices for you, because you can go to Jesus today. And this is one of those doctrines that sets us apart in the Southern Baptist world. But folks, I'm going to tell you something. I don't believe it because it's Southern Baptist. I believe it because the Bible says it. And that's what sets it apart. You and I have direct access. Peter's letting those Sojourner Christians know that God has not abandoned them. In fact, it's just the opposite. He's saying that God is using them, just like he's using you, he's using me, to combat all of the false doctrine that was invading the church. We, look at the people beside you, in front of you, and around you. We are that holy priesthood. We are. If we really got the fact that you and I can go before God and to have a radical one-on-one conversation with God, how would that change your prayer life? It would be monumental, wouldn't it? It would change immediately. And that's the greatest thing about it, is that you and I have that access. We can go to God. But now it is up to us that offers the sacrifices. What is that sacrifice? What is that sacrifice, you ask? It's real simple. It's the words of the Apostle Paul to the church at Rome in Romans 12, 1 and 2. And Paul wrote this, "I beseech you, I beg you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy." We talked about being holy, for I am holy, 2 weeks ago. Y'all remember that? Holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And we've talked about the mind over the past couple of weeks. Amen. So it's all coming together. By the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. That, church, is the sacrifice. But then Paul dives even deeper. He dives deeper in Galatians 2:20. Paul says this, "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who lives," you ready? "But Christ who lives in me." If you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it is no longer you who live, but it is Christ who lives in you. Hallelujah. "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live," how? "By faith in the Son of God who loves me and gave himself for me." It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. See, there it is, church. That's it. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. See, in verse 6, when Simon Peter is quoting Isaiah, he is saying that if we truly are being built into a spiritual house, then there is absolutely no doubt who our chief cornerstone is. Because he lives here. And even though men rejected Jesus, it does not alter the fact that it is Jesus who is the chief cornerstone in the work of building his church. In Psalm 118, Jesus is the cornerstone. In Isaiah 8, he is the stumbling stone. In Isaiah 28, he is the foundation stone. In Daniel 2, he is the supernatural stone. And in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 4, he is the rock that miraculously gave Israel water in the wilderness. This is literally, and I do mean literally, the parable that Jesus told in Matthew chapter 8 come to life. Turn back over with me. I'm going to be in Matthew chapter 8. Matthew 8. Actually, it's Matthew 7, I think. Matthew 7. In Matthew 7, come to life. He's literally going to bring this thing out. I'm going to be starting at verse 24 in Matthew chapter 7. This is Jesus talking. He says, "Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the..." On the what? "He built it on the rock. And the rains descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house and it did not fall. For it was founded on the..." It was founded on the rock. "But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rains descended and the floods came down and the winds blew and beat on that house and it fell and great was its fall." Church, we need to hear this. Simon Peter is telling those Sojourner Christians that are out scattered all over creation. He is saying, hold on. Don't you give up. He's saying it's time to refocus. Let everybody and everything take their best shot at you. It doesn't matter who and it doesn't matter what, because Jesus is still the same yesterday when you met him. He is still today. He is the same that's going to be tomorrow, and he is the same forever. See, he's telling these Christians, he says, "I understand that you're struggling." He says, "I get it. I understand that it's easier to give up than it is to get up." Boy, that's a big amen. It's way easier to throw in the towel than it is to get up and fight.
Simon's telling them, but you don't dare give up or give in because it is you, the ones who believe, it is you. You are the chosen generation. You are the royal priesthood, a holy nation. You are his own special people. Why? That you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. There's a purpose statement for every believer on the planet. That we will praise him, the one who called us out of darkness. Simon Peter is saying, the reason you're under attack is because you are making a difference. That's why the enemy is seeking to destroy you. You've got to remember, this is Simon Peter talking, and it's like he's telling them, you've got to remember that even the gates of hell can't stop you. Simon knew that, right? That's what Jesus told him. Don't you dare give up. You are now a people of God, and you have obtained the mercy of God. Church, I don't know about you, but I understand what it's like to feel like some of those sojourners sometimes. Amen? It's okay to admit it. It's okay. I understand the daily battles and the struggles of having to look persecution in the eye. I understand what it's like to literally take on false teachers and to have to defend against the false doctrines. But you see, here's the thing. That stops all false doctrine. This. And folks, I don't know about you, but I've got to do it on a regular basis. It's all the time. I mean, I get it. They felt alone. They were losing hope, and they were losing hope fast. And if I've been there, can we just be honest that most of us in the room have been too? Amen? I mean, in fact, some of you, you may be there right now. Some of you watching right now may be feeling that. Some of you watching right now or that will watch in the future, you understand what it's like that you are. You're literally ready to throw in the towel. Hope is fading, and you're doing your best just to hold on. Maybe that's you here this morning. If that's you, whether you were in this room or whether you were watching, if that's you, I want to encourage you in the words of Simon Peter, because he says this, to you who believe, this is to the Christian, okay? We understand that. This is to the believer. To you who believe, you are a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people. That's us, amen? That's us. To you who believe, he is your chief cornerstone, laid in Zion, and no power on earth can destroy it. All the rains, all the winds, and all the floods that Satan can throw at you cannot make it fall. And to that I say, praise God. To you who believe, Jesus is priceless. To you who believe, Jesus is irreplaceable. And so, church, is there any doubt in our minds now why Simon used the word to describe him? He really is precious. He is our precious living hope. I don't know where you are this morning. I don't know what God has been doing in your life, but maybe you were here and maybe you were struggling. Maybe you're here and you just simply don't know Jesus. You can walk out of this room today knowing that Jesus is your Lord and Savior. Amen? You can do it. You can know, leaving this room, that you are not alone and that if you are struggling, that there is hope. So as we prepare for our invitation, hear what God is saying. Hear what is tugging at you right here. Listen and obey. Will you bow your heads with me this morning? Every head bowed, every eye closed this morning. I just want to let you know I'm so thankful to know that Jesus Christ is our living hope.
And I'm thankful to know that that is a message that we can proclaim until the end of the age. He is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, and that hope never changes. It never deviates. It never gets off course. It never picks and chooses who it gives it to. Jesus is our living hope. So I ask you this morning, if you are here, I ask you this morning, if you're watching, if you've never given your life to Jesus, would you please come today? Would you come and make Jesus Lord and Savior of your life? And if you are here this morning, if you're watching and you are ready to just give it up, you're done. Let me just tell you right now, don't give up. Grab Jesus. He is your hope. Father, we just give you this time. Father, we thank you for your words. We thank you for your encouragement. And God, this day, move us from where we are to be closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, will you stand as our team leads us? Stretch your legs and do whatever. Then we're going to have a small family meeting. Our finance team has some things that they want to share. And then also, when that is over, some of you have already reached out to. Some of you come in a little bit on the late side. Dan, Lisa, Carrie, just hang around a little bit later afterwards. Okay, I want to kind of visit just a little bit. Got some things that I need your help with. So just as a point of reference. Mary Whittington, help me out here. We needed big eggs, little candy.
But we found some big eggs.
We found some big eggs.
We need candy.
We need small candy. Now, you may think, well, okay, candy's candy. No, that's not right, because it takes a certain size to go in the little plastic eggs. And so we've got tons of little eggs, but we don't have, and it didn't have as of Thursday, whatever it was, we don't have enough little candy. So we need some more and some more and some more little candy to help get this done. And those ladies killed on Thursday. And then Miss Mary, you were telling me we're going to do it again Wednesday morning at 10 o'clock. Okay, right here where the egg stuffing factory comes back. And so if you can, that's right. If you want to help, come on. It was an absolute well-oiled machine. And they kept shooing me out because I was hunting chocolate. So they were just trying to get out of the way. Everything else looks pretty much normal this week. Dr. Jones will be back teaching Sunday school online. For those of you who were not able to be here this morning, for those of you watching, you want to join us, that's Tuesday night at 7. We figured out a way to kind of beat the internet issues. So that was kind of cool this past week. I don't know, Larry's back in Sunday school. That was kind of fun. Don't forget, and we got to get to work out, April 3rd, 1 o'clock. is the Easter egg shindig. It's going to be taking place out here. All kinds of fun, all kinds of games. You got any questions, you need to help, you want to volunteer, see Heath and see Sarah. Okay, they're going to put you to work. Amen? Amen. They're going to do it. They got places. Busy week. God is good. Amen? Amen. Mark McGraw, will you close us in prayer? And then we're going to take a couple minutes, and then we will regather again. Mark, please.
Dear Father, we love and touch your heart's love to us. We thank you for your love, your mercy, your grace, and your truth. We thank you for your word that we can just communicate and talk to you anytime we want to. We thank you for that. We just thank you for your word that we can lean on in hard times. You're always there. Father, just give us the desire that we need to be a more like you, to be more Christ-like, that we'll just be a witness and share your word, the Son's word, each and every day of life. Father, we thank you for the message this morning. We thank you for our church and our faithful. Father, as we go through this week, just open doors. Just bring our church back together. Bring our people back in this building. Father, I know it's rough times. It's been some COVID times, but Jesus, we do need to trust and put all of our faith in you. Father, we ask these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. Folks, thank you so much for joining us. We want to just encourage you to join us Monday through Friday this week at 9 a.m. for coffee chat, as we just kind of kick back, chit-chat for the day, and we're taking a dive into 1 Samuel. Have an incredible week, everyone. If you need anything, you can reach out to us by phone, you can reach out to us by Facebook, or you can email us. We'll be glad to help you. Thank you so much, folks. Have a great week. Bye-bye.